Good morning to everybody. I'm G.H. Ching from Civil and Environment Engineering Department. I'm very honored to chair this public lecture to be given by our senior visiting fellow of IAS, Professor Reinhard Niessner. We'll be talking about a characterization of nanoparticles in different spheres, a very important topic. Before I invite him to start his talk, I would like to take a few minutes to introduce him to everybody here. Professor Niessner, he was a lecturer in inorganic analytic chemistry in 1958 in Germany, then served as a professor in the same field at the University of Dortmund from 1986 to 1989. So then he joined the Technical University of Munich, München, in 1989 among Xing as chair of the Institute of Hydrochemistry and Chemical Bonneology. Now I think the name is gone, right? Okay, that is means it's hot spring therapy study. Professor Niessner's main research interests include the environment analytical chemistry, particularly application of laser spectroscopy, nanoparticle characterization, and microarray technologies. And the main objective study interests also include aerosols, hydrocolloids, biofilms within hydro and the atmosphere. Currently, he serves as associate editor of the famous journal of analytic chemistry organized by, published by American Chemical Society. He also sits in various advisory and editorial boards of journals, including Analytic Sciences, Annual Review of Analytic Chemistry, Microchemical ACTA, Analytic and Bioanalytic Chemistry, Fresenius Environment Bulletin, Talenta, International Journal of Environment Analytic Chemistry, and Toxic and Environmental Chemistry. Professor Niessner receives various highly prestigious awards. For example, he got given the award Emmanuel Merkur Prize, maybe my pronunciation not good, okay, for analytic chemistry in 1990, one of the top prize in his field, and the Somolovsky Award for aerosol research from the Association for Aerosol Research in 1999, and the Fraser Prager Medal of the Austrian Society for Analytic Chemistry in 1996, and the Fresenius Award for Analytic Chemistry of the German Chemical Society in 2000. He was also a member, tutorial member in the International Union of Pure and Applied Chemistry on the UN, and served in the European Science Foundation and many other national and regional scientific organizations. Particularly, I want to mention to you, he was a founding member of RG's panel for SIMBES research. It's one of the biggest research program organized by RGC. Besides this kind of information, he has produced 140 PhD students and 190 master students. And his HI is 53, and he published around 600 papers. So with a short regards, let's give a big hand to welcome Professor Niessner.
Thank you so much, Professor Chen, for this very kind introduction. And I'm highly honored to be here at HKUST. Now it's the second time. Last year I was already here for this water workshop. And today I like to introduce a little bit my history in particles. And as you see here, characterization of nanoparticles, it's known to everywhere. It's becoming important more and more. It becomes, of course, also an issue for the environmental people and the toxicologists in general. So today I can only discuss with you or introduce you to some special topics. I like to present here some work what I did with my people in my institution, to say some words about my institution. You have read Institute of Hydrochemistry. It's identically to the
share of analytical chemistry. In total, we are currently 52 people. About 29 are PhD students of them. Yeah, so it's, a good mixture. And we are consisting of five groups. These five groups are all belonging to me. These are my assistants, so to say. It's the old German system where a group leader or an assistant can still be a professor, but he is not independent. So it's a little bit different to the tenure track system, but so it is. Well, so today I like to bring to you these topics: photoacoustics, that's a laser-based system we developed with some success to the automotives, and then I will speak about the usage of Raman spectroscopy. Raman spectroscopy is going up since about 10 years exponentially. I'm very happy I recognized that very early, so here one can make use of this a lot. And then that might be strange to you, optothermal particle separation and characterization of aerosols and hydrocolloids. Sometimes I will also say hydrosols. Yeah, so aerosols and hydrosols. A hydrosol is also a hydrocolloid. So the medium particles are suspended in is water normally. So, and finally, surface enhanced Raman spectroscopy. So it's let's say a special topic with Raman spectroscopy here to describe microorganisms. Okay, let's start. The first part I'm discussing is soot, and from my work at RCC, among the last 5 years, I know also about, also from some colleagues, one is here, and Chuck Khan, who is now at the other university. Soot is in Hong Kong also a very important issue. Yeah? So soot is everywhere. It's depicted here. I took it from Marik. He's right now the editor of Aerosol Science and Technology Journal. So soot is thought to be an agglomerate of soot particles, and these soot in detail is very, very complicated. Normally, we have the polycyclic aromatic hydrocarbons attached to it, so the semi-volatile or the volatile part may be among the gas phase, but the heavier one, like benzoapyrene, which is the really toxic, because cancerogenic one, that's attached to these particles. So, in general, these soot agglomerates are emitted from incomplete combustion, from the trucks, from the diesel engines. Germany, for example, we have about 50% of the small vehicles consist of diesel engines. I'm driving two, a Mercedes six-cylinder diesel. So this is emitting these, or hopefully not so much, but anyway, harmful particles. Now to understand the task for the analysts, and here I'm acting as an analyst, so to say, they need a soot sensor, and now according to this Volkswagen scandal you have heard from the newspapers, there it's with the NO2, but it's both. Yeah, it's not only NO, NOx, and so it's also soot, it's regulated, and the outcome of this scandal is they ask now for the mobile, for the onboard diagnostic. So no longer these engines will be, of course, developed on a test stand and so on, but the outcome will be they will ask for mobile sensors. So what can we do? Now these mobile soot sensors should be mass sensitive despite the discussions in toxicology. And they should have a sensitivity of about 10 micrograms per cubic meter or less. For the ambient aerosol, it should be about, let's say, 500 nanograms per cubic meter. But for the engines, that's the range needed. There should be a very small gross sensitivity to all the other components emitted from an engine. It's like an exploded pharmacy. Yeah, so you have to understand it like a cigarette smoke also, which is currently thought to be about 5,000, so far it's known, 5,000 compounds. also, so here we should be able to measure that selectively. We should have a time resolution of 1 second or less, because the engine, they change the conditions very rapidly when you have a heavier load or other changes. Then of course the emission, the engine is then combusting incomplete and emits for a very small time slot a huge amount of soot. So this should be measurable. It should be robust and mobile, and that's what I mean, these onboard diagnostics, or even onboard, let's say so. So the detection limit principles available so far in general should be within the spectroscopy, and we have two ways. First is photon emission. So the particles, the analyte of interest, emits something which can be used to quantify and qualify. So there we have the laser-induced incandescence. That's a topic where you simply hit with a laser beam on the particles. They start to glow. You measure the glow emission. That's possible. Or you make a breakdown. We developed also several devices, and right now we do it. So we apply again strong laser beams. We concentrate the photons within the soot, because the soot is black, so he is a beautiful absorber. So all the photon energy is concentrated within a particle. It becomes to form a plasma emission, so it makes really noise and gives light. So that's possible. It's very expensive. And of course you can also stimulate Raman emission, which is a very weak thing, but very interesting, because it gives other information. So I will show here something. And on the other hand, photon absorption, that's the counterpart. Soot is black, as I mentioned already. So we can use an ethalometer. The ethalometer, that's simply a filter. In Germany, they call it also Bacharach number or Bosch number, calling the company Bosch. Very known one, like Horibar or these. So Bosch, they may measure the blackness of a filter. That's of course not sensitive enough, and it's not in situ and online. We need in situ and online, and that's only fulfilled so far by this here, laser-induced incandescence, or, and that's my message to you, photoacoustic spectroscopy. Now, what does that mean? We started with the development for this device already in the 90s, very early. So for a good development, you need approximately 10 years. That's my experience I had in several fields, also in bioanalytical chemistry, where we also did a lot. And so 10 years is a good measure for it. So these are the particles, the agglomerates. So if we illuminate them by a modulated laser beam, indicated here by this red broken arrow, then these black particles pick up the light of any wavelength, of any, and they become heated up. Now, since they are suspended in some carrier, in a medium, in gas, in the exhaust, they also warm up the surrounding gas molecules, which means kinetic energy becomes enhanced, and this means the pressure becomes enhanced. So what we do is we apply here a microphone, and once we have here these modulated heating up and the heated, also the modulating pressure change according these absorption of laser photons, then we can measure that by the microphone. The interesting thing is that the detection signal, the pressure, is directly related to the concentration of the mass of these particles. As long as they are smaller than, as a primary particle, smaller than 800 nanometers. And that's fulfilled, as the soot particles are in the range of about 5 to 50 nanometers, because then they are completely absorbing by mass, not only by the surface. If they are larger, they simply absorb only like an onion in the outer part, in the layer. So here they are really transparent to the light. So that means the signal is depending, the pressure formation is depending on the concentration, and that's the most interesting thing, it's directly related to the laser intensity, to the light intensity. So the usage of a laser beam makes it's reasonable. You can enhance the sensitivity, and it's also related to a geometry factor. It's a photoacoustic cell itself. So now back to the basics of physics. If you have a resonance tube, like in a music instrument, in a horn or something like that, and creating a standing wave inside, then you have these pressure maxima and the minima. So the trick here is to place the microphone where you have a pressure maximum. So additionally, we have an enhancement of signal just by geometry. And we don't need an electronic device to enhance this sensitivity. It's done here by geometry. So the aerosol is continuously introduced in these small units. It flows all the time through it. We have a transparent window, sapphire windows here, and the modulated laser beam. That's an infrared, a near-infrared laser at 805 or so, where we have an optical window for all major components in the gas. So the trick is here to use the blackness of the particles, but also the window, the non-absorbance of all other compounds. Yeah? So that's the trick here. Okay, so in detail it looks like this. This is a small glass tube. You see the dimensions. That's the resonator tube. And so we can adjust here all these things. These are the specific data for it. And we can then directly here enhance the standing waves. And since the whole device is warming up with time, we were not the first to develop these things, but all had, so to say, a certain disadvantage, because with time the whole device warms up and it becomes shifting in the geometry, because it's expanding its geometry. So you have to follow that. And by using a small loudspeaker, creating a modulated tone, which creates an overlaid resonance, we follow the shift in the dimension and can adjust it. And that was the big trick we developed. So by that, we then were successful, and that was from the first. That was prepared by my workshop in the aerosol group, headed by Heisch. And you see here these differential cell equipment. So one cell is with filtered aerosol to cancel out influence by any gas, if there is one. Later, we build it like that, and nowadays it looks like this. So, and that's the instrument to the market. So far, we sold about 1,300 units. Give you a little bit of flavor for that. As an analyst, you can always make money with these developments. So, one unit costs about 30,000 euro, 300,000 Hong Kong dollar also per unit. So it's a lot of money which was created by that. And this gives you the calibration done by the manufacturer. That's AVL in Graz. It's like Horiba or Bosch, one of the leading measurement technology industry. And you see each dot here represents one running point of an engine. Yeah, and with at different situations, the elemental carbon was measured independently at a running engine fixed at a working load, and parallelly sampled and combusted. And so the elemental carbon was measured. By that, we could calibrate the equipment. That's the photoacoustic signal. And you see it's really independent of the different working situations. The LOD is what was demanded. And we have a very high dynamic range. So that's not shown here, but it's more than three orders of magnitude. And that's very needed, because these emission situation of an engine is changing rapidly. And how to qualify such a sensor, that's the response time of the sensor. Yes, you switch off and on with a zero signal or the full load of for a signal. And then the 90% signal, half of it, that gives the response time. And in the actual development, it's about 600 milliseconds. So here it's for one of the first developments, but just to show you how it's, so it's only the filling of the cell which really limits the response time. That's, so it's a very quick instrument. And this gives you directly the reproducibility. So this is the overlay of three cycles from a European test cycle, a dynamic cycle. So the engine is run, then they change the load and frequency, the rotation speed and these things. And if I explode up here, you see it here, so it's really reproducible. So reproducible means the engine. The equipment is certainly very reproducible, but also the engine is very reproducible. Okay, so now, what to do with that? Now, what's important to understand is what I mentioned. The incomplete combustion produces the soot particles. And this gives you the emission of an engine, the black trace here, for the different situations. And if they apply now an after treatment, and all the discussion right now with Volkswagen and others also here in Hong Kong is the after treatment to get rid of the NO2, the NOx in general, and the soot. And especially the soot becomes emitted when you change the workload. So even with the after treatment, there's a slip. Yeah, you see here that there's something becomes emitted. And again, it's more or less zero. So, and that's for the constant, for a constant European constant test cycle. That's for the transient test cycle. So here for different running phases of the engine. But always when you change, then you see here the white trace. That's exactly what the engineers need, this information. And they have to optimize the after treatment. Yeah? So that's the gap to fulfill. Now, NO2, Volkswagen has now the problem with the NO2. How to measure that? We can do that in parallel to the soot with the same principle that's shown here. Yeah? So we have here the so-called twin pass. So we use here diode lasers, the neodymium YAG lasers, and so we make a frequency doubling from 1.06 to 500 and something, and that's still in the absorption of NO2. So we can measure here at one wavelength the soot, and by mirroring the laser beam, we can also measure the other one. Yeah, both is working very well. It looks like that. Yeah, so it's built in my workshop. I have a small workshop, but a very good one. Only two people, but they are excellent. They make that. Yeah. So this is a real NO2 and soot emission. So the green here is from the photoacoustic. Yeah. The soot is also from that, and you see always high NO2, low soot, and the reverse, and the reverse. That's important to understand. NO2 and soot, they make an interaction, a very strong one. The NO2 serves as an oxidant in the after treatment, in the exhaust pipe, and consumes the soot. And so, nowadays, one part of the strategy in the after treatment is to enhance NO2 after the engine, consume the soot, and then they have a catalyst, Siemens Enox catalyst, which reduces the NO2 and produces nitrogen. Mm. And the soot is gone. Yeah? And if this is not working well, then you have the Volkswagen scandal. So that's the secret behind, yeah? So, and what's also seen, these noisy here, that's from the Fourier transform infrared spectroscopy device so far available by other enterprises. So in this experiment, our signal was very stable. This FTER was a little bit noisy, but nevertheless, it's fitting and matching quite well. So what we have developed is really in line with other developments, but we can measure both soot and NO2, which is not possible by others. Now, can we continue these developments? Yes, for the meteorologists. The meteorologists are very interested in the radiation budget. So the radiation budget, the so-called climate forcing, says something about the warming up by, let's say, sun illumination and so on. So our atmosphere becomes heated up. But if there is soot or sulfuric acid is thought to reflect something of the energy back to the stratosphere or to the sky, whereas the soot, if it's there, heats up. So what's interesting for those people in this area, climate forcing, they need to know the absorption coefficients of aerosols. But up to now, it's not easy to measure the absorption, the real absorption. Absorption is not extinction. Extinction would mean absorption plus scattering. Yeah? So scattering, we have to discriminate from the absorption. You have to know the real absorption. And you understand now photoacoustic spectroscopy is the only tool to measure, or the only base to measure the real absorption, because it cancels out any scattering. It measures only what's warming up is really absorbed. Yeah? So this is done here. So we used here an OPPO system, an optical parametric oscillator. So where we have here from, by principle, by from 400 to 2,600 or 500 nanometers, we can tune through these absorption, and then we apply it here in a three parallel resonance cell in the same operation as I discussed it before. And we could here acquire a limit of detection of down to an absorption coefficient 10 to the minus 7 per meter, which is rather low. It's really rather low. And now we applied that to soot aerosols. And this is a freshly generated soot from a sparking discharge across two graphite electrodes. Yeah, so ultra pure graphite, we create a spark gap between the electrodes, making a plasma evaporation, recondense that immediately, and by recondensation you achieve exactly the same as you achieve in the engine, in a diesel cylinder in the engine, where you have also these explosive combustion, a supersaturation, a chemical supersaturation, and this chemical supersaturation leads to the nucleation and to the agglomeration and this formation of these soot particles. And exactly the same is done here by sparking across graphite electrodes. And you see we could measure the spectrum for the first time here in the most interesting range, because that's where the sunlight is illuminating. It's even a little bit lower, but here, due to the limitation of by our lasers, we could measure it only here. But you see the freshly generated soot has a relatively high absorption coefficient, because that's directly reflected from that. We can transform that into the so-called angstrom coefficient. And if you age them, then the whole changes. It becomes less pronounced, but what's important, there is no specific absorption band. It's simply only increasing absorption the smaller the wavelength becomes. Yeah? So that's published, and these data can be used for calculations, for modeling, and so on. Of course, we can also measure other aerosol properties. Yeah? So that's very wanted, by the way, also by the military people. Because in the military area, you have these obscuration aerosols obscuring the infrared emission, and they need to know exactly the absorption properties of these obscuration screen aerosols. We come to the second part. Raman spectroscopy is a tool to describe the reactivity of these soot particles. I told you now a little bit about the soot, that this soot is unwanted, very unwanted. You have to get rid of it, and how to do that. Well, soot is not soot. The big message to you is to understand now that soot is black, of course, maybe, not always, but in most cases, but it's not always the same soot, and that's shown here. If you make an experiment and combust, and we call that the thermally programmed oxidation, so that's a manually performed combustion of different soot species. So that's this graphite, this spark discharge soot, which is produced artificially. And you see here on the abscissa the temperature for the oxidation, and we measure the oxidation by observing the CO2 emission. Yeah, so we measure that, and if it's combusted, then of course this is increasing, and you see this soot starts very early to combust, to become combusted, and that's the dream for all engineers in automotive engine development, because they like to have exactly such soot. What they don't want to have is this, it's the graphite. If you have a fully graphitized soot, and that's depending on the combustion situation, then it becomes inert. Yeah, you can heat up here to 1000 Kelvin, and then it starts to become combusted under oxygen. Here we applied a slight 5% oxygen atmosphere. And this is what the real engines produce. So it's somewhere in between. Yeah. So here you see the same here for these diesel soot. And these are soots from the Mercedes company, so in Stuttgart. So we are right now in charge for many of these companies to characterize the engine soot. It's a special task I have to fulfill. Yeah, they like to have it because the engineers need it to optimize their car. Okay, now what's the reason for that? To understand this, you have to have a look a little bit closer. Yeah, I'm right now also a visiting professor at Kyushu University, and they have a World Center for Ultra Microscopy. And here I show you some ultra microscopy pictures. We made it at the Max Planck Institute in Berlin together with Schlögl, a very famous, very known Max Planck director, and I had a project together with him, and so we could make these pictures. Yeah? What you see here is these spark discharge soot, which I just described. We spark, we evaporate, and make a fast condensation. So the molecules, the atoms of graphite, of carbon, don't have the time to rearrange to make fully graphene layers as it's shown here in a C60 soot, artificially produced with another Max Planck Institute, that was Müllen also in Mainz. He is the expert for super large PAHs. So that's a super PAH soot we produced together with Müllen here. That's in this application. You see, that's the magnified view of a soot particle. And when these graphene layers are arranged such, or that's the real exhaust, so it's a mixture of this and that. Yeah, so you have again these parallel but also these disordered arrangements. So the oxidation happens only here at the borders, at the interfaces here, where you have some open shells with free electrons where the electron attack and the reaction can take place. Yeah, so what the engine developers need to have is this. Then it can be oxidized immediately within milliseconds, because it's distorted. Here in that case, it's completely inert. It's like a graphite. So now how to measure that, to predict it from a spectroscopy measurement? Yes, is that possible? It is, because this combustion takes some hours. Yeah, it's a very lengthy procedure. We do it, we like it, because I charge them, so I earn money by that. But it would be nice to have a little bit quicker information, and that's done by Raman spectroscopy, because Raman spectrum, this fingerprint spectrum you receive in the Raman spectroscopy, where you illuminate, you have some information, you get some information about the polarizability of electrons under the symmetric or non-symmetric situation, like in spectroscopy, in infrared spectroscopy. And the big advantage is you have an in situ sampling, You can directly illuminate the soot particles and you receive an answer. And what's even more of importance is the Raman spectra reflect the nanocrystallinity, because if there is some symmetry rule broken due to the disorder, then you see it in the spectrum. So Raman spectroscopy by principle should offer this possibility to see directly whether such a particle system, not only for soot, it's our favorite, but you can apply it to different ones, then it should work. So that's just a setup as we use it. So here we observe our soot particle on a small filter, and what we receive is this famous spectrum of the D and G peak of the GFG soot, because that's very distorted. There's a special resonance. So here you see this graphite peak. So in case you have a real only graphite, you see only this peak. If you have a completely disordered soot, you see only this one. And now we develop the five-order band model and how to retrieve it and so on. It's described in this paper. That's my most cited paper now, 800 times cited. So it's used really by many, many people around the world. And as you see, you can, from the retrieval of these bands, you can describe a little bit the disorder of the whole system. And this is done here, and even we can use it, here you see, that's the highly oriented pure graphite. You see really only one peak. Yeah, that's what you have if it's purely graphitic. And here it becomes already disordered, and what you also see, and this we detected, normally, Raman spectroscopy, this effect, the Raman effect, should be independent of the excitation wavelengths. That's what the students learn in physical chemistry. It's independent of the wavelengths. No, it isn't. If there is a special phonon coupling effect, then you see, then the spectra becomes wavelength dependent. That's only with soot. We detected that. and this gives then a direct access to an easier development. So that's directly the differential signal. So if there is no disordering, you would not see this shadowed area. So here it's a huge disorder, should be most easily combusted under the after treatment situation. And here it's more or less inert, which then should not be combusted. And this is exactly depicted here. So that's the graphite at different wavelengths. So this is a model, an index we created between 1 and 0. So this is the most efficient, I think that's the graphite. That's the very inert situation. That's the most active and reactive soot, and here again you see all these samples we got delivered from the automotive engine developers are in between, but already approaching here, and the latest, the Actros series of the largest drug producer of the world, that's Daimler, was optimized by this technique. They have this engines producing this soot, already approaching the most reactive, the spark discharge soot, using what we did. So that's a little bit behind this Volkswagen scandal, what I mentioned before, and you know from the newspapers. We come to a completely different approach of laser spectroscopy to characterize nanoparticles. Now, what means optothermal particle separation? Well, that's the interaction of light with particles in this range. Yeah, so we observe the particles and they become hit by a laser beam. What do? They do something. They start to migrate under the influence of strong laser beams. But we can only observe that in that range. But that's an interesting range because it also contains pigments and bacteria, smaller and larger. It can, by principle, go down to a few nanometers, but also up to several tenths of micrometers. Yeah, so all is possible. It's a contact-free, it's an in-situ technique, and it's a forgotten technique. And I like to read old physical papers, old physical journals like Zeitschrift of der Physik, like Liebig's Annalen der Chemie, very old, from 1800 up to 1900, because these forgotten basics are only described there, not in the SciFinder or the Scopus or ISSI Web of Science. So you have to read sometimes the old journals. So, and 1910, the colleague Ehrenhaft at Vienna University in experimental physics, he observed that when he illuminated particles, normally that should be spherical, but there's some misalignment with the projector. Okay, so if we illuminate by a strong light beam these spheres, and if the absorption of light is inhomogeneous across a particle, then we have a heating up and some creep flow and some interaction which may be very complicated, and I'm not the expert for it. I'm the experimenter. I like to observe the things, but they must be reproducible. But we know a little bit from theory that the reason might be these uneven heating up. If this is the case here, then you can observe a push. You really kick away these particles from the light source. You can see that under the microscope. How can we use that analytically to qualify and quantify properties of these particles? And the same happens if you have particles which are, again, uneven in their composition, in the optical interaction with the laser beam, then it might happen that you heat up only the back part. Again, here, creating some special gas flow, kicking the particles towards the light beam. And if it's opaque, like a fog droplet, it's happening the same, you kick away that. In Germany, in the glass blower's shop, sometimes they offer these glass bulbs with a small light mill inside. So if the sun is illuminating these rotors of these light mill, it starts to turn. It's exactly the same effect. So, and we thought, well, maybe there's a chance to make something analytically. So we went into the basics and found this relationship. So this describes these so-called photothermophoretic forces when some photons impinge on these particles. So the force is directly related here to the diameter in some complicated way. You see here R is here the particle radius. So there, of course, there is an influence of that because you illuminate, so to say, the face of a particle. That's one part. Then on the other side, and that's again for us important, it's directly proportional to the light intensity, to the power of light you apply. It's quite clear, the more photons impinge on such a particle, there should be more effect than without any photon. But what else is important? Yeah, it's of course the fraction of the incoming energy that is absorbed. That's our analytical effect. Yeah? If there is any difference in the absorption, that's what we like to measure. Yeah? And what else? It's the thermal conductivity of the heat across the particles from the part where it's heated up and then becoming thermalized, going into the equilibrium. So you can directly measure, if you fix the other parameters, you can measure this parameter in situ. I do not know any other technique to do that. Okay, is that true? Yeah, well, how to study? So we build up a small aerosol cuvette, a small cell, that was done by a meteorologist, that was the PhD student, and you see we feed the aerosol through this small cuvette. We cross here by the NRI laser, the aerosols, and now to visualize the movement of these particles, we have to create scattering. That's done by the green laser, and the whole is observed by a CCD camera and by measuring the trajectories of the individual scattering particles. So it's not a single particle effect we observe here. We observe in parallel hundreds of particles. So we have an extremely good statistical base for what we are doing here. Yeah, you see. So if there is something, so the laser comes from here, the aerosol flow is here, and is it? And here you see the individual trajectories. So when they enter the laser beam, then we got kicked. Yeah, and what we are doing now is we measure the velocity, so we characterize these particles by its velocity. So it's a velocimetry, what we are doing, individual particle velocimetry, and it's also independent of the flow of the aerosol. That's meant here by these no gradient forces. It's only these photophoretic pulses really seen. And so we could measure here, that's velocity of these particles. So here we fix the particles and also the optical properties. And we looked whether these predicted relationship on power density is fulfilled. Yes, within the experimental scatter, it is for particles in that range. So that's really true. The same is fulfilled if we use now here for a fixed power intensity or laser light intensity, here the radius. So this here is the prediction, this line, and these are the findings with the experimental scatter, also true. And this is for differently absorbing particles of more or less the same size. So we used here polystyrene lattices of a fixed diameter, except this, yeah, you see here, that's, but these are same, but differently colored. Yeah, so it's shown here, and you see we can then really measure the absorption properties if we fix the other parameters or know it or create it, then we can measure the absorption properties. Now this gives some qualitative feeling on how atmospheric aerosol behave. So make haste, that's one of the leading officers at EPA in Raleigh-Durham. He was in my lab for some time, and here we simply we observed the photophoretic velocity for differently produced aerosols, polydisperse, no monodisperse, and you see these ones, they are the opaque ones, they are kicked away. So that's a positive sign here. If they become carbon, here for example, engine soot, they become attracted. This urban dust, by the way, is a special one. That's from September 11. Because EPA, they collected the dust and he brought some samples. So that's the famous New York September 11 dust. The soot itself shows a very interesting behavior. So they enter the beam and then make these loopings due to the agglomerates. So far we think it should be possible to, by observation of these special behavior, we should be able also to say something about agglomerates, because when the first part of an agglomerate comes into the laser light, then it already is a force. The rest is outside, so it makes a ball, like a bola. In Argentina, they have this special bola, and they behave the same. Yeah, so the theoreticians try to mimic these things, but so far it's not resolved. Is that possible also for hydrosols, for the other sphere? Yes, it is, but then it becomes easier. So the whole behavior, so the thermal conductivity and so is canceling out. the velocity to be observed is directly related again to the laser light intensity. It's directly related to the size and the optical property here, abbreviated Q. And it's the same arrangement now for hydrosols. So here we have now a hydrocolloid pulled through these. And you see, it's again the same behavior. It works exactly the same. So that's a relationship to the power for different light intensities, photophoretic velocity. And so it works perfectly. We try to make separations, which I cannot show now here due to the limited time I have. Let's come to the last part. And again, to Raman spectroscopy as a label-free technique to describe now special particles, and that's microorganisms. Before I do that, I have to tell you something which is known to the water people, but may not so known to the aerosol people, and I address this lecture to both. And so the real particle threat, and that's also, in my opinion, for the aerosol, it's not so much the soot and the heavy metals and PAHs and so on. It's more these pathogenic microorganisms. And we do right now a lot on Legionella aerosols and other bioaerosols because I'm really convinced of that. So simply more population, more germs. And especially in the water science and water technology, the recycling poses a threat. To get rid of ions and other small stuff by osmosis or filtration and both, that's all possible. But if there are some viruses, and even one virus is enough, WHO calls now, in its latest requirements, one adenovirus in 90 cubic meter of water. That should be the limit. Please measure 90 cubic meter of water. So far, no water work does it. Anyway, even in Hong Kong, they do not measure any virus. So they have their indicator organisms, and that's it. So, so bacteria and viruses, that's important. And here's a little bit told about the history. That's what currently is wanted just by cultivation, zero in 100 milliliter water sample. But of course, that's statistical problem. If you are lucky, you have no microorganisms within these 100 milliliters. But when you drink water more than 100 milliliters, you may be unlucky to have with 105 milliliter a lot of small bacteria and other things. So here you see this, what I mentioned. So how to detect these things? And normally now by PCR technology, or by mass spec with MALDI-TOF MS, they try after cultivation, by the way, here. So that works only after cultivation. Then they think they are able to identify even individual particles, which is not true, because by this magnification in PCR technology, you also enhance the misfits and any other errors and so on. And on the other hand, you have the lipid polysaccharides at the cell wall, which is asked by the antibodies, because they interact with the cell wall. So they differentiate the lipidomics, so to say, of these microorganisms. But instead of antibody-based, which I show in a moment just before I come to the surface-enhanced Raman spectroscopy, you have to enrich the whole thing. And the whole enrichment, I make this sidestep because we did it and we are so far one of the very rare who really did it and even sell it. So we make, in the meantime, even for 90 cubic meter, huge enrichment units, and we sell it in the moment to institutions, to also the legal bodies of our state, and so they sold it now from us. And, Also, we enrich by cross flow. We make then a monolithic bioseparation on affinity, small affinity columns, and then so here, for example, from 10 liter samples, but even from 90 cubic meter samples, we go down to 500 microliter, and then into our microarray equipment, this platform we developed so far in Munich. I'm very proud on that, because that's also an outcome of my institute that was developed again over 10 years. Yeah, so it's typically, so it's a flow scheme, many pumps and so on, and here is inserted the microarray, which is in two channels. One channel is actually analyzed, and the other one is recovered, so to say, regenerated by chirotropic solutions. And in the meantime, this is measured. We measure the chemiluminescence of this chip, but that's not important for the moment. Yeah, so we can combine that with oligonucleotides and antibodies, and finally with enzymes. We make the splitting here, and so here the information, the magnified. Here we magnify in a logarithmic, in the linear, semi-logger, in a linear range in the PCR application. So we magnify, and then we identify again by the enzyme here through the chemiluminescence on the chip, and so we are able here shown for E. coli. But in the meantime, we published that already. I did not put in these slides here, but it's published in the meantime right now, the January edition of Analytical Chemistry, isothermal PCR. So we can make it also for viruses. But now to the surface-enhanced spectroscopy. The surface-enhanced spectroscopy makes use of nanoparticles again. We found out, three, 4 years ago, now in the meantime, a series of publications has been published, not only by us, but also by others, where we directly coagulate inside such cells on the individual spots under the microscope, under the Raman microscope. We apply these silver colloids, so silver blasts is directly interacting with the cell wall and therefore magnifying the Raman spectra, the Raman fingerprint of these lipid polysaccharides, and then we can directly analyze even strains of different bacteria. And here one can see that a little bit. So in that case, if it's only coagulation externally mixed, then you have only a small fortification. If you make it in situ, then the silver particles become directly formed and are in a strong interaction with the lipid polysaccharides around these cell walls. And then you receive a very strong signal. You can even discriminate live and dead bacteria by that. That's now also accepted by other groups in the meantime. Yeah. So, and that's the big message. So these surface-enhanced Raman spectroscopy is an extremely powerful tool. We right now got awarded a project by the German Research Foundation together with the urologists because there they like to see the immediate action of an antibiotic on bacteria, which normally uses the cultivation. So you have to wait for 3 days until you receive a result whether an antibiotic is counteracting against your bacteria or not. And 3 days is a lot. In the meantime, you may run into a sepsis. Yeah? So they are very eager to have an information within 1 or 2 hours. That now seems to be possible by this technique for the first time. That's I think, very valuable here. It's shown. That's again this magnification, and you see here different strains of these E. coli by these SIRS, and you can apply some chemometric data treatment to discriminate these strains, and in the meantime it's done or more, so that seems to work very well. So, we are at the end of my small lecture. Small summary and some conclusions. First of all, I think these particles are of special interest. So if you are interested in aerosols, in hydrosols, in these things, please focus on water people on this. Of course, there are many other nano and micro particles which are of importance. And in the air, it's soot. I mean, when I was in the panel for the theme-based research scheme, I had to evaluate so many applications here from Hong Kong. And they did a lot on modeling and fog and photochemistry and so on. But what is real, the threat for you is here, around the harbor, from the trucks released, and because they claim to be Euro 6 and so on. It's Euro 1 or Euro 2. The fuel they use is beyond any quality. So it's so please focus on these things, make experiments, make new equipment, technologies to detect them in situ and online and so on. Well, optothermal response of nanoparticles with laser lights, that seems to be interesting, especially also for separation. I have a special lecture on that. And there I show also the real separation of particles by light. That's possible. You can sort them, address them. Those have to respond. They go to the left, the other go to the right. And so you can make an optical separation. So then, of course, these techniques for the onboard diagnostic, photoacoustics and these things, laser substitution, these lasers are expensive, quite sure, but anyway, they are bought, yeah? People buy it, so it's nice, but to make it smaller, the LEDs, yeah? So we have the white light LEDs in the meantime, and we can also substitute the microphones by tuning forks. Tuning forks are within the watches, yeah? For example, as a normal, a frequency normal, and you can make measurement, for example, PM2.5 could be measured if you impact the aerosol of interest directly on the vibrating forks. You're changing the resonance frequency of these forks, but you can use them also as a microphone. It has been shown already. This shrinks the whole device. So the idea is to shrink this equipment to very, very, very tiny sizes. And Raman spectroscopy. I mean, this goes really up. As an editor of so many analytical journals, I can tell you it's really so, this exponential grow, and especially for nanoparticles and for bioparticles. So please take your attention on this. And what we need, microarrays, or and also, I mean, we are favoring the microarrays, but others favor the bead assays. You can also address different beads with different receptors and with fluorescence, and so it's possible. But in our case, these microarrays are regenerable up to 70 or 80 times. That's not possible with beads. And on the other hand, it's label-free because we don't use any label except the nanoparticles. These are all labels, so to say. Yeah, so this surface-enhanced Raman spectroscopy, I think you will hear more. And people wait on that. So far, nobody did it. Mix these colloids, these hydrocolloids, these nano or silver particles, bring them into a coagulation with the bacteria or whatever, and make your cytometric measurement. That would be interesting. If someone applies here for such a project with TBRS, then I would see a good chance. Yeah, here you see my people. These are some group heads in the front. Yeah, so Helmbrecht did the photophoretic measurements. Seidel is the microarray guy. Here we have some. That's Knopp, Dietmar Knopp, Reinhard Renneberg knows him, and well, these are the ones who funded some work, also our army.
This is your normal group meeting with beer?
That's the normal group meeting we have once a week. No, that's not true. So that's a special monastery brewery, driven by monks.
near Munich, and well, here my part of my people are sitting there. I have to thank you for your patience and for inviting me. Now you can kill me. Now please come up.
Thank you very much, Professor Niessner, for your excellent talk. At least myself learned a lot, learning something that we can pick up your tools to look into our problems in water system, in microbial system, and as long as we regard them as archaeum particle, whatever in hydro or gaseous form environment. So we are really learned. And it's not only characterization of physicochemical, we also look at reactivity. So your promotion Raman's, and we also seriously think about that, what we can do. Mm-hmm. Also, you know, give us a home take-home message that if you're on the right, the team best, better to work together. Okay, this is a short regard, and now I open, I think, invite our audience to raise your hand, ask any question you like.
Just my students always push me about Volkswagen story. And I have some trouble to explain it. And first question is, I believe you don't drive a Volkswagen, right? You drive a Mercedes.
Right.
How come the Mercedes has no problem and Volkswagen has a problem? Very simple question.
I always explain it by simply having a look into the records of SciFinder. And you see what are the research departments of the companies publishing.
Ah.
I'm also within the bodies. We have a special body in Germany that's an agency for research on automotives. And there Volkswagen plays a role, but only in directing research, but they never presented any research.
Ah.
Whereas Mercedes and MAN is the competing truck manufacturer, also a very global one, they presented a lot of research, of own research, and I have still about 15 people, former PhD students, are within these companies, but nobody with Volkswagen. So Volkswagen, about 10 years, they are discussing a lot, but they never presented anything. So they actually do no research. That's my explanation.
It means you had a bad feeling already of the whole time.
And the other real explanation might be also the cars are smaller of Volkswagen. Yeah, they have 2 liters or 1.6 liter or 1.2 liter diesel engines, whereas the MAN drives 7 liters. Yeah, so and MAN is a 3 liter engine, a 6-cylinder. So the huge engines, they need the after treatment, and this after treatment, it's on a really good basics. It's well understood. Mercedes uses NO2 for oxidation, so they enhance a little bit first, as I explained, the NO2, make a hot oxidation of the soot, and then make a second catalytic step to remove this enhanced NO2 and turn it by adding a little bit of ammonium. That's the BlueTech, so-called BlueTech technology. So I'm driving with an ammonia tank. In my back of my car, there is a small urea tank heated up, splitting a little bit ammonia. And with the Sinox catalyst, it forms nitrogen. So, and that's also MAN is using that, but Volkswagen, they do not use it. So nobody knows.
So the message is for me now, they should ask you for advice. I mean, Volkswagen, have they been so stupid?
We are within this body, but
they could save millions, billions of damage.
They observe all. They know it. Yeah, but they simply decided not to apply the costly after treatment. So if you are with the trucks, this Actros line of Mercedes or the MAN trucks, they have all these. Also, the larger, small cars, they have an after treatment, but that costs. Yes, it is, so it's about 1 or 2,000 euro. So it means 10 to 20,000 Hong Kong dollars. Yeah. So additionally, and they save it simply for competition reasons. Yeah.
They do a lot of job in business in China. Get some different ideas, right?
If they pay me.
Any questions?
As Professor Chan said, really excellent talk, very interesting, very informative. I love it. So I have several questions for you. So for the first one, so for suit nanoparticles, so what's the major ingredients or components in it? So mainly carbons, polyhydrocarbons.
Yes, they are attached on as the outer shell. Yes, so but they do not change much the optical properties, but they are attached to it. And they are also, when warming up in the after treatment, they are more or less combusted too. Yes, so they are removed too. But the relationship of adsorbed PAH to the soot, I would say it's 1 to 10,000. Yeah, so if you have a 10 microgram soot, then you will have some nanograms of PAHs. So it's the relationship is quite clear. The soot is the problem. And some metal oxides. So you have also, they cannot be combusted, of course. They are not seen by the photoacoustic, but they are still there. So if you go, and that's now the latest topic, I did not say anything about that, but we had also huge projects on it, using biofuels, that's coming up now. You are blending the petroleum fuel with biofuel. Then you also insert a little bit more oxygen and also contaminants, which are created by the bio process, that means the whole periodic system appears then in the released soot as metal oxide. It's not only abrasion from the cylinders, it's directly in the fuel to a small percentage. So it's a complicated system, of course. Yes, okay. You are right.
So my second question, so you devised a very nice device to measure soot nanoparticles. That's called so photo acoustic spectroscopy. You have an equation P, the function of a laser intensity. I choose a wavelength 800 nanometer laser. So why did you choose that wavelength? Because later you also talk about...
Because there is the optical window. All the other ingredients, we have up to 20 grams of water. And water is, of course, also a contaminant optically, because in the infrared it absorbs a lot. So we have to find wavelengths where no absorption by all the other exhaust components do absorb the photons, except the black soot. So we are using a window where only the black soot is absorbing the light. That's the reason why we have to select and find a wavelength where only the soot absorbs. And the gram, compared to micrograms, 10 to the 6 or even more, is there of other components they should not absorb. So we have to find this optical window. This was 807 or something. That's one of these optical windows.
Later, you also showed other wavelengths, like 450 and 808.
That's for the NO2. So we also, what's interesting now for the water people, we have a project right now funded by the Excellence Project program in Germany for N2O. Also, N2O is a climate-relevant gas, especially emitted by the water treatment, by the sewage water treatment plants, yeah? But also by the combustion engines. And so we developed that. It's not published so far, but we apply it already for sewage water treatment plants. It works beautiful. Yeah, so we can select other wavelengths now for the concomitant components. Yeah? If we are interested only in soot, we have to find a window. If you are interested in some others, then we have to find the absorption properties of the gases, for example. And you can even calculate, so there are data banks where it gives you a prediction of the wavelengths to be used in infrared spectroscopy that can be calculated. And usually it's working very well.
So after, once a gasoline or diesel is combusted in an engine, and then you have a nitrogen oxide, and then you have soot nanoparticles. So
yes.
You propose to
yeah, but you can
one as
differentiate
an oxidant,
it.
The other as a reductant. So after reaction, so nitrogen oxide becomes a nitrogen gas,
yes.
And a soot particle becomes carbon dioxide. And then they are harmless. So that's a real good idea because so we really want to remove soot particles and nitrogen oxide. When they get into the air, they're really harmful. But also in the engine, so you have those soot particles, they can attach to the inner wall of engine and even the electrodes in the engine. That's also very harmful to the engine.
Yes, yes, yes. There are many problems with But as I mentioned, if you are interested in particles or gases, one way would be photoacoustic spectroscopy. Of course, there are others. But that's our way.
So also in the exhaust gas, so you have sulfur dioxide.
Would be also possible, H2S also. When you have reduced conditions, the engines does not only emit sulfuric acid and SO3 and SO2, it emits also H2S.
They can also act...
You can smell. It's also possible to measure.
They also act as an oxidant.
Yes, it's possible. You have only to change the wavelengths.
Oh, okay. So last question. So for that label-free microbial strain characterization, you use a silver ion. So why did you choose a silver ion instead of any other ions?
That's the surface enhanced effect is related to the presence of silver or gold particles as the best offering this magnification effect. This surface enhanced effect was found 20 to 30 years ago, but you have to have these ultra-fine small silver or gold particles present because they only make these super effect up to 10 to the 11. Yeah, so it's a huge magnification. Usually it's only 10 to the third, but under some circumstances you can observe very huge enhancements only with silver or gold. Yeah, not with other metal particles. It depends. But on the other hand, silver is very labile. It's chemically not so stable. So it's a trade-off. Yes, you have to find it. Of course, there are many attempts to use also other metallic, curved, embossed substrates, not only particles, also embossed, roughed substrates for collecting the stuff you are inspecting. So there are many attempts, but the best so far is the silver. And we found a special recipe published by Lendl. It's also in our paper. And it must be a freshly produced silver. If it's an aged, then it's not so good. Yes, it's delicate. Because it's like an amplifier curve in the electronics. If you have any instability, the amplifier makes a huge noise and a statistical error. But so far, silver and gold.
The question is very simple. Since myself is involved in monitoring outside air quality with government, and at this moment, it's ongoing to have a control program to replace some heavy diesel commercial trucks. So actually, in Hong Kong, we have this need to monitor soot. But I guess in both ambient environment and also the emissions from those heavy-duty diesel vehicles. So my question is, with your photoacoustic spectrometers, is it possible to be sensitive enough to detect ambient concentration of soot?
It would be possible. We also developed for the meteorological service in Germany one to substitute the nephelometers, yes, for example. That's running at one station. But the customers, the number of customers are quite clear with the automotive. So we made it with the automotive people. Uh-huh. It's a question of the resonance cell. Yes, you have to apply a special cell to get a higher magnification. and you need to have a stronger laser, which makes it a little bit more costly. But by principle, it's working. Yeah. So, and Pöschel, you know, my former group head was Ulrich Pöschel. He's now the Max Planck director in Mainz, successor of Grutzen. He uses also other photoacoustics.
Yes, that's my second question. Like, in Desert Research Institute, they have a photoacoustic-based instrument for suit.
It's developed by others, yes, yes.
So I just wonder what's the difference between your instrument?
No, that's not our instrument. We focused on this automotive issue, yeah, but because that's simply a huge market. Yeah, but Petzold, he was the first student with me. He's now head in Jülich at the Helmholtz Center there. With the atmospheric, he developed the first photoacoustics, and later other people's Heisch, he made it for the automotives. Yeah. But of course, these photoacoustics are working quite well. And I know many people here use the etalometer, and the etalometers, they have, and that was shown by Petzold in many publications. If you have heavier aerosol loading of these filtrations of the membrane filter, then by scattering within the fibers, and it becomes very difficult. It's also well cited. It's one of my old papers with Petzold. So in, of course, it's cheap. Etalometers are cheap.
I
know.
I'm almost running up. Take right of the chair. I've just asked one question because really, I think that's also interesting.
Yeah,
very simple question.
Monday is anyway visitors' day. I'm.
You can for information. Professor Niessner's office here. You can come to talk to him. He's welcome.
Monday would be great. Yeah,
Monday.
Someone
and
likes to drop in. Welcome.
Today is busy. Tomorrow morning is maybe.
Also, I'm.
You can
ask and.
Anyone interested can come to his office to talk. And that's a great opportunity for interactive learning. Okay, whatever discussion or learning.
Yeah.
The final question from me is that I think you are not only published papers so much, also you develop a lot of products. So
yes.
how can you transfer the knowledge into industry?
I'm not sure
your group making all the so many pieces, devices, right?
Yes.
Is that a lot of company come to?
For example, the photoacoustic I sold after a conference. We had aerosol conference, a big one, the European in Karlsruhe. Right after my lecture, I immediately got the first 100,000 euro contract. Within 1 hour after my lecture.
1 hour.
It's quite simple.
So most likely is that you are working with a big company rather than a small company or what?
Both.
Okay.
So it's with the photoacoustics, you need to have a big one because the entrance, the access to the car makers is not open. It's limited. You must be within the club. Otherwise, you can make what you want. You can develop the most beautiful instrument. Nobody will use it. Yeah? You must become accepted. And since I'm in since 30 years to Mercedes-Benz, she knows the people, Borcher and Schmidt-Ott and these guys. We in the 80s, we developed the photo emission, the aerosol photo emission. It's also an in situ technique for PAH, adsorbed on particles. We got many awards for that. So most of the awards I received for that when I made it with the ETH Zurich. And since...
Who in ETH?
ETH Zurich.
Yeah, no. Who?
That's Andreas Schmidt-Ott and Heinz Borcher. These are in the experimental physics.
Okay.
Yes, and since that... So huge, small companies and... It depends.
Sure. Okay, we needed to close up this fantastic public lecture by Professor Niessner. Thank you.
I have to thank you.